Today, we're going to talk about how body armor is made. So we see a lot of interest, a lot of comments from people kind of about homemade body armor and really how body armor is made. So we thought we would do a teardown on some of the most common types of body armor, really get into how they're made, show how they're made, and hope to provide some more information for you there. Now, body armor uses a lot of different materials. There's a lot of different types of material or a lot of different types of body armor, and really each has their pros and cons. So you're going to continue to see lots of different materials and types of body armor in the market because none of them are perfect. If there's a perfect type of body armor, everyone would use that body armor, you wouldn't see anything else, but that's not the case. So we're going to try and stay focused today on how it's made. We're not going to try and get into the weeds too much and going to try to keep this video under, 30 minutes. So my video guy, if I get rambling, he's going to cut me off. So let's do it. So first off, we'll talk about soft body armor. We did a video on soft body armor, a very in-depth video on it. Went more into how it's made, what's used in it, different variations on it, the benefits, pros and cons, and use cases. So if you want more information on soft body armor, go check out that video. It goes more in depth on it. But basically, soft body armor is typically level 3A. You can also have it level 2 and level 2A. They're just not as common in the market. But either way, level 3, 3A, level 2, level 2A, it's all going to be similar in the way that it's made. So soft body armor is going to be made out of aramid fiber, or Kevlar is the most common marketing name for it, but there are other companies that make it under different names, or a UHMWPE. And now there is a wide variety of these materials, a wide variety of Kevlars, a wide variety of UHMWP materials. They're going to vary in their thickness, their weight, and it's going to change your makeup. So here's just a few examples of Kevlar materials as well as UHMWPE material here that we use with our soft body armor. So there's a lot of variations. There's a lot more than this in the market. So if you get some soft armor, it's probably going to have different makeup. But the way it's made is generally going to be the same. So how this is made is you're going to take layers, a certain number of layers, and the number of layers is totally going to depend on what material is used. You'll stack those layers together, and then you'll sew it all together, and you'll put it in a protective sleeve like this. This is just protective sleeve. Really, that is to keep the elements off it, keep the rain or keep the water and the sun from it, because neither of those treat this material very good. It's not really going to provide much ballistic protection, the outside sleeve. It's really just protect from the elements. Now, obviously, the thickness of this is totally going to depend on the materials used or the combination of materials used to make this armor. But that's basically it. That's how you make soft armor. It's pretty straightforward. Really, where you get into the details of it is knowing which type of material to use, getting the right material, using the right number or right number of layers of that material, and then also getting a combination. So as I said, we use a combination of them with our armor just because it allows us to maximize the performance of it. And really you got to find the right combination to, one, and most importantly, is meet the NIJ standards for level 3A or whatever level you're going for. But then secondly, you want them to be as thin as possible. You want that plate to be as lightweight as possible and also to be as affordable as possible. So that's kind of a breakdown on how you make soft body armor. Next, we can jump into hard armors. First off being steel. There's not a lot of makeup that goes into your steel body armor. I'm not a metallurgist, that's even how you say that word, and I don't claim to be, but I'll just give a quick breakdown on some of the metal we use for our steel armor. So we use AR-500 steel for our level 3 body armor. Now, AR stands for abrasion resistant, and your 500 refers to your Brunel hardness. Really, that's just telling you how hard the metal is. For example, we use AR-650 with our level 3+. It's just a harder metal. It's gonna be more capable of stopping additional rounds. So the higher the Brunel hardness number, the harder your steel plate is going to be. AR metal is a high carbon alloy metal. Now that high carbon composition of the metal is what really allows it to be extremely hard and extremely durable. AR metal goes through a heat quenching process where basically they heat it, cool it down. Now this process changes the internal structure of the metal, changes the actual structure of the metal to make it hard, less brittle, and really make it a good option for body armor. How you make it? I mean, you get the right metal and you kind of have body armor. Now obviously there's a little more to it than that. We buy this in large sheets, we then laser cut it to the shape we want. And there's definitely a big caveat here. So you can't just go down to your local metal shop, laser shop, whatever it might be, and say, hey, I want some AR-500 metal. You get it cut to the size you want and you have body armor. The issue you're gonna have is just inconsistencies in performance. So your AR-500 metal, isn't exactly AR5, isn't exactly 500 on the Brinell hardness. You're going to have variation. So some will be less hard, some will be, you know, above 500, some will be below 500. Now, that's fine for most use cases for AR500 metal, but it's not necessarily okay for body armor. You need to hit a certain hardness or this plate will not perform as it needs to. It will not meet the level 3 standards. We don't just use any regular AR500 metal. The steel we use is specifically made for ballistic protection. So every batch of steel that is made is tested to make sure the hardness meets the requirements. It's tested to make sure it meets the level 3 requirements for body armor. So that's the way it can be guaranteed. We tested this a lot. Trust me, we got a lot of AR500 metals from a lot of different places, shot them. Some would stop, some wouldn't stop. You just don't get the consistent results. You need to be assured that that is hard enough to meet the standards. The other thing on steel, obviously, is you want to put a protected coating on it. If not, it's going to rust out. And then the other thing is the curve in it. So we put a curve in these plates, the AR500 and AR650, which is not necessarily an easy process. This metal is very hard. It is tough to bend. But I'm here to tell you, you want a curve on that plate. Nobody is flat. It's going to be way more comfortable if you have a curve on it. So that's basically your breakdown on your steel armor. Next up on your hard armor is going to be your polyethylene or your UHMWPE plates. These plates get a little more technical. They're a little more difficult to make, for sure. This isn't something that is probably capable for just anyone to make. But to get into it, so how these plates are made, you take a unidirectional UHMWPE material, like this one here. Now, they're stacked together, layers of this are stacked together in a mold. Then that mold is put in a press and it is pressed under extreme pressure while being heated. And that bonds all these layered individual layers together to form one solid piece of armor. So that's what you have here. Here it's solid, you can see that. This is actually just a whole ton of layers of that material that's all been pressed together. It's actually pretty awesome. It's pretty awesome material, very good functional body armor. Now, the thing on this is you're gonna get a very large variation in materials used here. So this is one material used, but there are a lot of different materials. There's different companies that make it, and within each company, they have different levels of UHMWP material. Now, depending on the material, it's going to affect the thickness of your plate. It's going to affect the weight of your plate. Also, it's going to change how much pressure needs to be used to bond those layers together. It's going to change the amount of time and the amount of heat. So all those factors come into play when you're pressing these. Really, the key here is that these need to be bonded well. They need to be, when you stack these layers in, they really need to be bonded correctly, or you're going to have issues. The biggest issue you're going to have is that they'll delaminate. So when a round hits that, impacts it, it gets stopped in there, but these layers will pull apart. That's inevitable. You shoot this enough times, it's going to delaminate. Those layers are going to start separating. But the NIJ standards require 6 shots to meet the NIJ standards. So it's got to stop at least 6 and still meet the back face deformation requirements. So you really don't want those layers delaminating. So there's a bit of technicality that comes into this. The other piece is, and this is the real reason not anyone can just throw these together, is when I say these need to be pressed under extreme pressure, I'm not talking like you get your hand clamps and crank that thing down. These are put in a big press. You know, you have a 300 ton press. Some of this material even takes up to 500 ton presses in order to bond that and fuse those layers together. There's also a lot of technicality that goes into it. A lot of trial and error in terms of knowing how many layers to do. You need to know how much pressure to put on those. You need to know how much heat, and you need to know the time. So you got a lot of variables that come into play there. It's definitely a time consuming process and trial and error process to know how many layers, your time, your heat, your pressure, and even small things like letting it cool down in the mold versus pulling out of the mold. All these things can affect the performance of these plates. So there's definitely some technicalities going into this, as well as some hurdles to try and jump over if you don't have access to a 500 ton press, which most people don't. So that's basically how you make these. This armor here is going to be your lightest weight rifle rated armor though. These plates, you know, you're just over 3 pounds for some of these and less for others, and that's gonna depend on the material. So here's a good example. Here's 2 of our polyethylene plates. So they look the same. They're both made from UHMWPE, but you can see here, this one on the right is just over 1 inch thick, while the one on this one is 0.6 inches thick. So a lot thinner. This one weighs just over 3 pounds. This one weighs just over 2 pounds. Now, they both meet the same requirements. They both have the same stopping capabilities. The difference here is the material used. Your UHMWPE material used inside is your only difference. Now, also, as we kind of talked about, obviously one was pressed, a little different pressure, time, and heat and everything, but that's really going to come down to the materials you use, and it's going to vary plate to plate and manufacturer to manufacturer, and it totally depends on what they're using in their UHMWPE plates. So that's kind of UHMWPE. Super awesome body armor, really kind of cutting edge body armor. And it kind of leads us into our next and last piece of armor we're going to talk about, and that is your ceramic armor. So ceramic armor is typically going to be level 4. That being said, it can also be level 3 and 3 plus. Your polyethylene cannot reach level 4. So if you get level 4 armor, it is ceramic. Now, how ceramic armor is made. So first you have a ceramic strike face, hence calling it ceramic armor. And behind that strike face, you will have a backer. Usually it's going to be most often a polyethylene or UHMWP backer, just like this bad boy here, only it'd probably be thinner because it also has a strike face of ceramic on the front. Now, how this works is your ceramic is a very hard material, harder than armor piercing, which is why it's capable of stopping it. So when that armor piercing round or any round hits that ceramic strike face, it is going to start to break up, mushroom that round. It's also going to slow it down significantly so that it'll break your ceramic. But as it starts to mushroom, it's going to slow that round down enough that your backer material will catch that round, so it won't penetrate through the armor. There can be a lot of variations on your ceramic armor. Just like UHMWPE, your poly plates, your backer material here is going to have, you know, a variance just like one of these is. So depending on the material, it might be thicker, might be thinner, different capabilities of it. Also, your ceramic strike face has a lot of different materials. Some ceramic is harder than others. The performance of it will be better. And so, you know, some common ones are aluminum oxide as well as boron carbide. So in order to get that stopping capability with like a cheaper plate, you're probably gonna have a thicker ceramic strike face, which also means you're going to have a little heavier plate and a thicker plate, but it'll probably cost less. Different types of ceramic, you might not need such a thick piece of ceramic to perform just the same. So there's kind of your variance on that, on both your backer as well as your strike face. Now, the backer material doesn't necessarily have to be polyethylene plate. There are other backer materials you can use. I think most commonly today, most commonly used is your UHMWPE for a backer. Another thing to take into consideration here is that your ceramic strike face, ceramic is prone to fracture and break. So a lot of companies do here, you'll see this around the edge. This is just a foam padding that goes around the edge. So if this is to drop and hit the edge, it's less likely to crack and break your ceramic, which would cause a vulnerability and it's at risk of failure. So they put that padding around the edge to protect it. Similarly, on the strike face, that's what you see here. You have your ceramic, you have your backer, and on the top here, this is a foam pad. So that's just a soft foam pad. That is to help prevent the ceramic from cracking and breaking. So part of the NIJ standards testing, they actually drop the armor on the face. They put it on a board, actually drop it down straight so it hits the face, and then they shoot it afterwards. Now, if it cracks the armor, that armor is much more susceptible to failure and to not passing the standards. So they'll put this foam piece on front just to protect that, to help prevent it from cracking. Another piece that goes into this armor, into ceramic armor, is the adhesion between the backer and the ceramic. So you can see those things are nice and tight. There's no way you're getting those apart. So a good ceramic armor will have good adhesion between the backer and the ceramic strike face. You don't want those separating and you don't want them moving around. They need to be adhered together well, or you're not gonna get the performance out of the plate that you need to. So when that impact round hits, as we said, it will break your ceramic. That force and energy from the round hitting, that ceramic will blunt it and slow it down, but it's gonna shatter your ceramic, go through and get caught in your backer. What you see oftentimes with ceramic plates is companies will put a material over the face of that ceramic. So there's a ceramic strike face here, right? There's your ceramic strike face. Over the front of this is actually a layer of Kevlar, of woven Kevlar. Now that woven Kevlar is glued down, epoxied down, or adhered to the face of that ceramic. And really what it does is it helps the structure and integrity of that ceramic strike face stay together. So when that impact round hits and shatter and breaks it, the ceramic is not gonna spread as easily and break out chunks all over. It's gonna help contain it to that same spot, which will help with multi-hit capabilities. Also, the type of ceramic used, the depth, the thickness, and other factors there will also affects your multi-hit capabilities on a ceramic plate. Now, you get a lot of variations on these. I mean, just think about, we talked about the polyethylene plates. That's used as a backer here, and you get all kinds of different materials, thicker or thinner. In general, your backer is going to be thinner than a standalone type poly plate, just because it's got that ceramic strike face that is going to blunt that bullet and slow it before it hits the backer. But regardless to say, that backer can vary in thickness depending on the material used, as well as your ceramic strike face can vary depending on the material used. So you have a couple big variables there that'll affect the performance, the weight, and the thickness of these plates. And that's really why you see a lot of variation in the market. I mean, when you start looking at ceramic armor, level 4 armor, there's a really big price range. You get a lot of different thicknesses and a lot of different weights on those. And that's just because the different variations on the materials use the backer as well as the strike face. But in general, that's how it's going to be made. While there's variations, it's kind of generally how your ceramic is going to go together. You have a strike face as well as a backer behind it. And then obviously a cover over it to protect from the elements and other things. So that's kind of a rundown on, you know, the most common types of body armor and how they're made. Now, I'm not saying this is the only way to make body armor. I'm not saying there's not other ways to do it. I'm not saying there's not a lot of variations. We talked about how there's a lot of variations within these. If you go and buy a bunch of soft armor plates, you're going to see all kinds of different materials in every single one of them, I'm sure. Different thicknesses, different materials. That's just because there's a lot of variations out there. But in general, the process is going to be the same on how that's made. Same with your polyethylene armor. The process on how that's made, it's going to be layered together, put in a press, pressed under extreme heat and pressure to bond it together. And your ceramic plates are going to be similar. You're going to have a ceramic strike face. You're going to have a backer behind it. Whether those vary, and some of the technical parts are going to vary on those, but the general process is going to be the same. So I hope that provides a little bit more information on how some of your more common types of body armor are made. If you have any questions about this video, comment below, or if you just have any questions in general about body armor, give us a comment, shoot us a message. We'd love to address them in future videos. Until next time.